blessed by that. Hello, hello. Good morning, good morning. Woohoo. We're good? Right.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. We have a ukulele band joining us. Chords That Bind Us is their name. They've been together about 9 months, and they're going to help us worship today. Amen?
Amen.
Yes. I'm so glad you're here. Welcome if you're on visiting with us online. I learned right after I became a Christian, 40 years ago, that worship is a verb, and I found that intriguing. So when we come here to gather as God's people before a holy God, we don't sit and, you know, watch or observe, but we participate, and I know you know that. We engage. We play ukuleles or organs or pianos. We sing. We engage our mind and our hearts. We listen to God's word, and we want his spirit to move in us and through us. Amen? And let's do that this morning. I want us to read together from some scripture. Let's stand together, and we'll read from John and Romans and 2 Corinthians and on. Let's read it together. From the fullness of his grace, we all have received one blessing after another. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. And having loved his own who were in the world, he now showed them the full extent of his love. And God demonstrates his love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. You know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that you through his poverty might become rich. Because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace that you have been saved. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. I wanted to read something out of the book of Revelation, chapter 19. It kind of paints a picture of what's happening in heaven. There's a celebration going on. In chapter 19, it says, "Then I saw heaven opened, and there was a white horse, and its rider was called Faithful and True, and he judges justly. His eyes were like a fiery flame, and on his head were many royal crowns. He has a name written on him that no one knows but he himself. And he wore a robe dyed with blood, and his name was called the Word of God." And we worship him this morning. Let's sing to him.
Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns all music but its own. Awake my soul and sing of him who died for thee, and hail him as thy matchless King through all eternity. Crown him the Lord of love. Behold his hands and side. Rich wounds yet visible above, in beauty glorified. No angel in the sky can fully bear that sight, but downward bends his wandering eye at mystery so bright. Crown him the Lord of life, who triumphed o'er the grave, who rose victorious through the strife for those he came to save. His glories now we sing, who died and rose on high, who died eternal life to bring and live. lives that death may die. Crown him the Lord of heaven, one with the Father known, one with the Spirit through him give from yonder glorious throne to thee be endless praise, for thou for us hast died. Be thou, O Lord, through endless days adored and magnified.
Pray with me. Jesus, we worship you this morning. You deserve all the thanks and praise. We owe you our very lives as worship and thanks for you and for all that you've done for us. Your holy word says we will receive crowns in heaven, but we would like to symbolically, in our hearts and minds, throw them at your feet this morning. We cast at your feet our lives and our service to you, for you are so worthy of all our praise and adoration. Lord, you taught us in your word to pray, and you gave us an example, and we pray that this morning. Let's pray it together. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. This is the day that the Lord has made. The ukulele team is going to help us as we continue to worship. Sing it together.
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made, I will rejoice and be glad in it. And be glad in it, and be glad in it. Oh, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. No turning back.
Amen. Thank you, guys. You may be seated. I think we have a Guatemala team going to share with us about their ministry. You need this mic.
Hello, everyone. Good morning. My name is Christina Walra. I'm co-director of student ministries here at Trinity, and I'm very excited this morning to invite up a couple of our Guatemala team members to share about their trip. So if you two want to come up to the front now, this past week, we took 15 people, 7 adults and 8 students, to Magdalena, Guatemala, where we spent the week serving God in the city and seeing how he is working to change lives for the better in this country. It's a beautiful country that is very near and dear to my heart, and I had the absolute privilege of working with these two wonderful people all week. So I'm going to ask them a few questions, and they're just going to share a little bit about their experience with us. So this is Pat. This is Abby. Woo. All right, so Pat, let's just start off with, why did you decide to go? What made you pick up for a week of your summer and head down to Guatemala with us?
My son's in the youth group, and the youth group does a trip during their
Amen. I like how you referenced that Romans passage that we studied throughout the week of perseverance creating hope, right? Ultimately coming to spiritual development. Yeah, and again, I really appreciate how you highlighted meet the physical need, but also the spiritual reality of how these Guatemalans partnered with us, you know, and taught us as we worked alongside them. So, yes, thank you so much, Adam. Yeah. It was amazing serving with you. And now, Allie, I'm really excited to have you share because I actually got to serve at the same work site as you. So tell me a little bit, why did you decide to go to Guatemala?
So the Lord called you to take a step of faith.
continue to go forward in faith, that you would bless them, bless our Guatemalan brothers and sisters as they serve you, as they take bold steps of faith. And may we continue to do so as well until we go again next year. We praise you, God, for everything that you did and are doing. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. Welcome to Trinity. We're so happy to have you today. If you're new or if you're a guest, come by the Connect Us today. We have a free gift for you. Fill out that Connect card. We can't wait to meet you. We have had so much fun this summer at Trinity Summer Nights. We just had our last one this week. It was Wet and Wild Night, and we had foam. We had hot dogs. It was so much fun. Thanks for spending summer with us. College students, come out tonight at 7 o'clock. We're having a worship and prayer night in the sanctuary. It's going to be beautiful. Next Sunday, August 21st, it's our Trinity 101 membership class. Get registered. You can do that at our membership page now. It's that time, you guys. We want to pack the house with backpacks for our students in Detroit. It's for elementary students only. You do not need clear backpacks, so go pick up some backpacks for those students and drop them off by August 24th. You can stop by our Connect desk and grab a supply list here, fill up those backpacks, and drop them off. On Sunday, August 28th, we're gonna have a back-to-school prayer morning at both services. So we wanna have all those backpacks here, and we wanna have our students here. We wanna have our teachers here as well. We wanna pray over you guys. We wanna pray over our students and teachers as they head back to school. So get those backpacks in. We wanna bless our students in Detroit, and we wanna bless our teachers and students here at Trinity. August 28th is also training day. We have so many volunteers that make all of our ministries happen, but they have to be trained, right? So on August 28th, if you are part of Connections Ministry, if you are part of Group Leaders or Trinity Kids or Awana, we have training for you that day. Be sure to go to our events page and RSVP that you're gonna be there. We're gonna get you equipped for an awesome year. If you would like to give today, you can do that very easily by heading out into our gathering space. You'll find some giving boxes there. You can also do that on our app and our website. Thank you so much. Now we're going to get into our new series about the body of Christ, you and me, called Body Sculpting.
Well, good morning. Mark, it's great to be here with you guys today. It was so fun to have you, Pat, and Allie share up front. There's a great Guatemala trip. We have been getting reports all week long about some of the cool things that you guys saw and experienced and did. Ukulele team, thank you. Their CDs are on sale at the back when you leave. All proceeds go to them. We're beginning this new series today. I want to begin by reading two verses for you, Romans 12, verses 1 and 2. If you want to turn there in your Bibles, on your phones, and your apps, it would be on the screens as well. This will just kick us off, and I'll explain what we're doing in the series. But these are incredible words by the Apostle Paul, inspired by the Holy Spirit, and he says this: "Therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will." And so, Lord Jesus, we pray that you would bless the hearing of this passage and open our hearts to your truth today. In Jesus' name, amen. So a young boy was walking into the kitchen where his mom was at, and he had a trail of hibiscus petals that were trailing behind him, and he was a bit frustrated. And he said to his mom, "Mom, why is it that when I try to open up this flower, it looks like this, and when God opens it up, it looks like this?" And it's beautiful. And his mom didn't exactly know what to say at first. And then the thought struck her, and she said, "Son, the reason that that looks so beautiful when God does it is God's opening it from the inside. God's opening that flower from the inside. You're trying to open it from the outside." And that story helps me to set up what we're trying to do in this whole series, because I think that helps us to understand the difference between the transformation that God wants to do in us with just going to church or religious observance or whatever you want to call that. Because when God opens us up from the inside, we can truly be the person that He created us to be. We can flourish, we can grow, we can shine to the world and be His hands and feet. It's the church family that God wants to display before the world. He's the one that opens us up from the inside, that can't be forced from the outside. I can't preach it into you. Our church staff can't program it into you. It's something that only the Holy Spirit can do in us. He's the one who grows us. He's the one who transforms us. He's the one who shapes us and sculpts us into the people, individually and as a church, that He wants us to be, so that we can have a significant impact on our community, so we can have a significant impact on our families, our neighborhoods, and the world around us. And so the reason that we're doing this series and what we're up to is it's called Body Sculpting. We're going to dive deep into three chapters of the New Testament, Romans 12 and 1 Corinthians 12 and 13. Because in those three chapters, the Apostle Paul, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, uses the body, the physical body, your body, my body, as a metaphor for the church. We're all under the headship of Christ. And he explicitly helps us to see how this body is meant to be shaped. What is this body to look like? How do we act toward one another? How do we live this life of faith in Christ? And one of the reasons I'm passionate about this at this time of year is in the last 2.5 years, this church, along with every church pastor that I've talked to, their churches, has gone through significant transformation. We're a lot different church than we were 2.5 years ago. The makeup of our people here in this room is a lot different. Many of you weren't part of our church family 2.5 years ago. Many of you were part of another church family, or you've come to Christ in the last 2.5 years. It's just a different world that we live in. We're a different people on the inside and even as a church family. And so by God's grace, I'm so thankful that our church is really, really healthy. When we were doing well as an organization, and so many of you are growing in your faith, and I'm thankful for that. My concern, my passion, my heart is that I want us as a church to continue following in what God has for us and to be passionate about what God's passionate about, to grow and to change and to be the people that He wants us to be, to live the ethos of the church that He's created for not just this church, but for every church across the ages. And Paul helps us in these three chapters to understand what that ethos ought to be like. He understands in these three chapters that we're not just a collection of individuals. We actually are the body of Christ in this local expression here at Trinity Church in Plymouth, Michigan. And you come from all over the place, and we gather together. We're online, we're in person, but we together are a church. And in this passage that I just read, Paul begins to help us to understand how the Holy Spirit wants to sculpt us as His people, how He wants to shape us, how He wants to remake us. He's talking to the early church in Rome, but He's also talking to us. What are we to look like? How do we respond to the call of Jesus in our life? So He wants to see a church that's sculpted by the grace of Christ. We're living the life of the age to come. We're overcoming evil with good. A shorter way of saying that might be this, that He wants the kindness of God to motivate our church to live under grace. Here's a more condensed way of saying it. Here's our sermon in a sentence today. A church shaped by grace is a remarkable place. A church shaped by grace is a remarkable place. So in these three short chapters, Paul is going to talk about how, using the body as a metaphor, how we all work together under the headship of Christ, how everybody who bears the name of Christ walks in the way of Christ. We lift up the glory of God. We lift up the gospel of Jesus. We live in supernatural harmony with one another because we're empowered by the same Holy Spirit. Every person in a church, in this church, is valuable. Every person has gifts. Every person is needed by the whole, no matter how insignificant you feel. No person ought to be critical of others or be superior or feel superior, because every single one of us needs every single one of us. When hurts happen, we don't run away. We mend the hurts. We don't retaliate. We forgive. And there's this supernatural glue that holds all of this together. That's Paul's dream and vision for the church of Rome, the church of Corinth, and the passage we'll look at next week, and for our church. I know that that's his goal for our church. I know that that's God's goal for our church, because that's God's goal for every church of every age, in every location, and every time. A church shaped by grace will be a remarkable place. Amen? So, let's dive into an incredible passage. There's so much stuff in these two verses. I spent a lot of time in the last couple weeks unpacking them, and there's so much I left on the cutting room floor that you won't get today. So come and talk to me afterward. I'll give you the Cliff Notes version today. The first thing that I see in this passage, though, is that we are invited. We are invited to be shaped by grace. That's what God invites us to. That's what Paul invites us to. That's what Jesus invites us to. He says this in the beginning. He says, "Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy." Now, here's the thing. I know we've jumped into chapter 12 of this beautiful 16-chapter book that Paul wrote, this letter. And for 11 chapters, he has been telling us something. That's where the therefore, that's whenever you come across therefore in the Bible, you have to ask, what's it there for? What is he saying? There's 11 chapters of stuff I've told you about God's mercies. And in view of that, I'm going to tell you what it looks like to be shaped by grace. What does it mean? What kind of mercies has he been talking about? Literally, it's a plural, not just God's mercy singular, but God's mercies. For 11 chapters, Paul has been saying, there is some incredible grace and mercy that God has shown to you in Christ. For 11 chapters, he's said, there is mercy and there is grace, and every single one of us has received it because we're followers of Jesus. It is God's mercy and kindness to you and to me that he gave his son to die for us when we were undeserving sinners. Amen? This is God's mercy and his grace to us that he justifies us freely by faith. Faith alone. It is God's mercy and his grace and his kindness to us that he has accepted us into his presence on the merits of a perfect Savior, not because we get it right and that we somehow figured it all out. It is because of Jesus alone. It is God's grace and his kindness to us that he's given us his life-giving spirit to be with us every single day. It is God's grace and his kindness to you that he has made you his child. Amen? This is amazing. Paul has been going on and on. It is God's grace and his kindness that he has created a new way to be human for us. It is God's grace and his kindness that he has made a way for us to have relationship with him, the living God of the universe. It is God's kindness and his grace that he has put us together in the church to lean on one another, to learn from one another, to experience the gifts of other people. It is God's grace and his kindness that we have the hope of eternal life. Amen? So for 11 chapters, Paul's been going on, you have received so much grace and so much kindness. Wouldn't it be cool? Just think about how we respond to people when they say, hey, how are you doing? And maybe you're going through some hard times. I've been challenged by thinking, what is my answer? What if my answer, instead of talking about, man, it's been really tough. It's been really a hard time we're going through. What if the answer was always something that started with this: God has been so good and so kind and so grace-filled to me in my life. He's taken me through some tough times right now, but God fundamentally is good. That'd be kind of cool, wouldn't it, if we responded that way? God's grace, God's goodness. He says, therefore I urge you in view of God's mercy. The idea of urging is an invitation. It's this, it's not a command. God's not saying you have to be shaped, you have to do this, or there are consequences as a result. He has given this incredible invitation. I was trying to think how that would look. And this week, Monday, I went with some of the guys from the church to a great concert over at Jackson County Fair. And how many of you have ever listened to Switchfoot? Some in this service, there'll be more in the next service. Switchfoot's a great Christian band. Great rock band. that have, the members of the band are Christians, very explicit about that. And so we're sitting at Jackson County Fair, and we're listening to these great songs. And there's six of us. We all love Switchfoot. We went to see them. And John Foreman is the lead singer of Switchfoot, and I've seen them, I think, four times now in concert. He's a great showman. And one of the things that's awesome about John Foreman, one, he made a mistake because they way outperformed the band that followed. They were the opening band. Collective Soul was the second one. These guys way outperformed Collective Soul. So Switchfoot, John Foreman, in the middle of one of his songs, early on in the set, he's like just crazy in love with performing and the crowd. And so he does what a lot of guys do, but you could just tell he loved it so much. He grabs his microphone, and he's out in the stadium. There's the stands up in the back, and then it's just the fairground, just dirt, and there's chairs. And so he's just out, and he's singing along, and he's going just like this, and he's taking selfies with people. He's like, hey, you know, he doesn't know the names, but he's grabbing Mike's phone, and he's holding it up, and he's just taking a selfie like this, and he's grabbing John and putting his arm around him and, hey, like this. And he's letting John sing his song. And Anthony, and then he grabs Anthony's hat and he puts it on his head. And he's just going crazy. And you can just tell how much he loved singing. And he's urging the crowd to sing along. And so, you know, like every rock star does, you come to the line where everybody should know it. And he's holding the microphone out. And everybody's singing along. You're meant to live for so much more. And it's just crazy. You can tell how much he loves. He's urging us as the group that's listening to join in, to not just sit and listen, but to participate, right? That's the idea of this invitation that Paul is given. Paul loves you, loves the church, he loves the people of God, and he's urging us in view of God's mercies. I'm inviting you to be shaped by grace, to sing along in this song that God has for us. That's the sense that you should get when you're picking up just in these two simple verses or a few words at the start of verse 1. He's inviting us to be shaped by grace. In view of all that God's done, you've got something in store for you that's way beyond what you can imagine. I love that about this invitation to be shaped by grace. And he's going to go on to say, here's how here's what it looks like to be shaped by grace, but here's what I want to warn you about. And you need to understand this, that Satan does not want you to change. There's ways right now that you're thinking to yourself, I don't know where he's going with all this, and I don't know what kind of changes in my character that God might want, and I'm not sure what Pastor Fuller is all about or what the Holy Spirit wants to do for me, but Satan is sitting there telling you, I don't want to change. He says, I don't want you to change. I don't want you to become more like Christ. I don't want you to grow in your compassion, in your forgiveness, in your grace, in your mercy, because, like, will I even be the same person anymore if I change and I grow that way? If I'm shaped by grace, what will that look like? He's trying to convince you. The father of lies is trying to convince you right now to not change. And I'm just here to say the Holy Spirit wants you to grow, to be more like Christ, to understand who God is in all of his glory, and in view of those mercies and all that God has for you, he's inviting you and he's inviting me to be transformed, to be sculpted, to be shaped by grace. Amen? That's what he's got in store for us. So we'll just spend 4 more weeks talking about this, right? But I'm going to give you some ideas today, like what are we up to? And Paul right away says, here's how we're going to shape, God wants to shape you and sculpt you by grace. Here are the ways that you're invited to do that. He's urging us first, just 2 things. Urging us first, choose to live under grace by offering your whole self to God. Choose to live under the grace that you've been given by offering your whole self to God. He says, therefore, I urge you, I invite you, my brothers and sisters, a term of endearment, in view of all that I've been saying, all that I've been showing you, all the mercies that God has given to you, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. He's using language from Leviticus, from the Old Testament, from the priests who go to the altar and they offer a sacrifice to God, a worship to God. It's something is dying in order to be offered to God. And he's asking us, he's inviting us to offer our whole selves, our bodies, as a living sacrifice. We don't have to die, although we died to Christ, so maybe there's some of that going on. But we're offering ourselves, our whole selves, our bodies, a living body, as a sacrifice. And the idea that it's your true and proper worship essentially is saying this: in light of all of those things, in light of the mercies that God has shown to you, the only logical thing that you could do, if you've received all that, what can you do other than worship? Choose to offer our bodies. That might mean literally our body parts, because we're embodied people, all of us, everything that we do. From early on, 4th century, Chrysostom, who is a great preacher, said, when he was asked the question, how should the body be a sacrifice? He answered this way. He said, prevent your eye from looking at something evil. It has become a sacrifice. Do not let the tongue say something shameful. It has become an offering. Do not let the hand perform a lawless action. It has become a whole burnt offering. Yet these things are not enough. We must also perform good works. So it's not enough just to not do things. He says, let the hands give alms. Let the mouth bless those who abuse. Let the hearing devote itself continuously to listening to divine speech. For sacrifice has nothing impure about it. Sacrifice is the first fruits of all other actions. Let us then make a sacrifice to God of the first fruits of our hands, our feet, mouth, and all other members of our body. That's from the 4th century. A great commentary by Michael Byrd from 2 years ago. It says this: what we do with our bodies shows what we value with our soul. One of the things we can simply do is to trim our lives of excesses, whether that's in food, drink, entertainment, or anything that's self-indulgent. We should live in such a way as to make clear that our bodies belong to God and not to Starbucks, Netflix, Forever 21, or Apple. We choose to live our lives, give our whole selves over to God. The second thing that he's inviting us to is to get our minds aligned with God's purposes and plans. Get our minds aligned with God's purposes and plans. He says, do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. We give our whole selves. We are invited, we're urged, John Foreman, Switchfoot style, to give our whole selves and to have our minds be transformed, to have our minds aligned with God's purposes and his plans in our lives. Real change begins with new thinking. Real change begins with new thinking. When we change our thinking about God, about ourselves, about our church and one another, our actions and our feelings begin to follow that. We change our mind. We ask God to renew our hearts and our thinking. And he says there's two things that are going on in tandem here. There's one that's a negation and one that's a movement toward. We're refusing, on the one hand, to conform to the spirit of our age. That's what the idea he says, do not conform to the pattern of this world. Literally, this age, this eon, the spirit of this world that's controlled by Satan, not the world that's controlled by God. We refuse to let that way of thinking conform us to itself. And then secondly, on the positive side, we're pursuing transformation. We're pursuing the transformation through renewal of our mind. Dallas Willard calls this the renovation of the heart. We went out to Colorado Springs a couple weeks ago. I was taking my classes in Denver, and we were staying with my daughter and her husband. And it was really fun. They're in a new little place. They're renting it from brother-in-law. So Tim actually is getting paid to renovate the house. It's been in the family for a while. It's an old house. And so the first thing that you do if you're in a big renovation project is they had to throw away like tons of old tchotchke, like just stuff all over the house that belonged to the former owner. And so they're like throwing it out, little by little and all over the place. And then it's kind of a chopped up house. The walls were kind of funky. I was in there before they started. And so Timothy has the ability to do this. He's tearing out walls. They're ripping down cupboards. They're ripping out floors. I would never try this in my house. He's doing all this stuff because he knows that if you're going to do a complete renovation of this house, you've got to get rid of the old stuff in order to do the new stuff. And so that's basically what Paul is doing. You've got to get rid of the old stuff. You've got to throw out the trash, get rid of the stuff that's holding you back, and then you get the new stuff that comes in. The Holy Spirit is working in our lives to do all those things. So the first thing we've got to do is refuse to conform to the spirit of the age. And real change requires cleaning house. If you want physical health, you've got to stop doing things in your life, like eating so many Doritos or whatever it is. I'm not saying autobiographically. If you want a healthy schedule, you've got to learn how to prioritize things. If you want a healthy mind, you've got to change what's going in. Again, Michael Bird again, he says, and this is true for us, just listen to these words. Wherever we go, we are bombarded with messages in advertisements and in media to adopt a certain perspective on things, whether that's fashion, cars, politics, or entertainment. We are given information not simply to inform us about something, but to cajole us into thinking about something in a certain way. Marketing experts, I was a VP of marketing at a company one time, I'll tell you this was true. Marketing experts want us to change the way we think about ourselves or a certain product in order to lure us into purchasing that product. Media outlets and movies often aim to engender sympathy for a certain person or to provoke prejudice against a certain argument. It is all rhetoric, the art of persuasion, vying for attention, mining for recognition, and courting influence over the hearts and minds of the masses. And we as Christians are part of the contested territory that ideologues, journalists, actors, academics, writers, comedians, and politicians are striving to sway. Our TV, newspapers, our internet are awash with a constant battle of ideas, with people competing for our adherence to their ideas. You are constantly being sold. You know that. Most of the time, it's really, really subtle because we're good at selling in our culture. Real change, transformation of the mind, not conforming to the pattern of this world, will involve a lot of throwing out the trash, a lot of cleaning of the house. So here's a question for you, because I don't know what's going on. I don't know what you're struggling with. I don't know what you're wrestling with. I don't know what lies you have believed, or even sometimes what lies I have believed. But I'm going to ask you a couple questions. I want you to reflect on this, not just now, but as the day goes on, even as the series goes on. How is the world trying to squeeze you into its mold, as one translation of this passage goes? And are there things that you need to stop doing or throw out? Are there things like my son-in-law, Timothy, is throwing out stuff like mad in order to have the new stuff come in? Is there stuff you need to throw away? And how would you know? I want to give you two questions, two diagnostic questions. How would you even know what's going on that you need to throw away? Maybe we'll tick you off for a second, but two key questions. One is this: is this thing drawing me closer to God? And second, is this making me more like Jesus? Whatever it is, whatever you're reading, watching, your friends, whatever, is this drawing me closer to God, or is this making me more like Jesus? So here's a question. Is watching Fox News or is watching Sean Hannity making me and making you more loving, more compassionate, more peaceful, and more kind? Because if it's not, you should stop. And I should stop. I could give you different news stations, whatever you're watching. In your life, are you willing to throw away some stuff? Are you willing to put some stuff? Because everybody, conservative, liberal, all stripes, are trying to persuade you to their ideology. And all you have to ask is, is this making me more like Jesus? Is this helping me know God better? I'm not going to ask for an amen because I'm afraid what you'll say. Does the amount of time, here's a second question, just along those lines, is it driving me closer to God? Is it making me more like Jesus? Does the amount of time I spend on my hobby draw me closer to God, or is it pushing me away from God? Because all of a sudden I don't have time to come to church. I don't have time to be in a small group. I don't have time to read my Bible. I don't have time to do my devotion because I'm doing X so much. That's a question to ask. Is it drawing me closer to God? A third one. Does the stuff I look at on the internet or the TV shows that I watch, do they encourage me to be sexually pure? Paul's not even saying don't do these things. He's saying ask this question. Is this helping you be shaped by grace? Is the stuff that we're watching, listening to, helping us to grow closer to God and to be more like Jesus? Do the friends that I spend time with encourage me to be honest, to not be a gossip, or to grow in my relationship to God? Diagnostic questions. Because if the answer is no to those things, Paul is inviting us, urging us to clean house, to refuse to be conformed to the spirit of our age. Amen? Refuse to be conformed to the spirit of our age. On the positive side, he says, pursue transformation through the renewal of our minds. Real change requires cleaning house on one hand, but real change requires us to learn the truth, to have God's truth, the truth infused by the Holy Spirit as we read His Scripture, as we understand His Word, to transform our mind, to help us know what God is like as we're reading it, and to understand what we're meant to be like, and to be empowered by the Spirit. We're to pursue transformation. Not be passive about it. He's urging us, in light of all that God has done, pursue transformation. Don't be passive. And as we read scriptures, we understand the Bible. The Bible shows us the path that we can take that's healthy and that's whole and that brings us flourishing as human beings. It helps us to understand how we got off the path, if we're off the path in different ways. It helps us to understand how we get back on the path. How we stay on the path of following Jesus. We pursue transformation. And so, I'm going to give you some real practical things. This fall, we're going to begin our sermon series and our life groups studying the book of Revelation. I'm excited about this. I'm nervous, but I'm super excited because the more I've studied Revelation, the more it's just rocking my world. Because Revelation, if we read it rightly, teaches us all sorts of incredible things about the glory of God and His activity in the history of this world. And it teaches us how we pursue Him in the midst of a world that's pressing in on us and trying to squeeze us into its mold. We'll offer all sorts of life groups on Tuesday mornings and Wednesday nights. Will be discussion questions, a book to go along with this. I want to give you every single opportunity that I can. To pursue transformation of your mind, the renewal of your mind, because you're soaking in this incredible letter that most of us think in this room is just for those people out at the end of time when Jesus is about to return. It is for all of the church of all time. It's incredible. So, do you want to have your mind transformed? Then hang out with us a little bit this fall and dig in. We're going to do that. I want to give you all those resources. Maybe it's joining a journey group. We got on the website, we've been promoting this for a year. We've had dozens of people now start this spiritual growth pathway in our journey groups, learning what it means to love God and to love others and to pursue transformation. We've got opportunities for you. You can't leave here today. I'm going to really challenge you. You cannot leave here today and say to me, I just don't have an opportunity to grow. I don't know where to go. Because I'm telling you, we have dozens of things that we can give you. And we've got them on our website. We've got people that want to help. We want you to follow this invitation to have your minds transformed and renewed and to grow in the likeness of Christ because of the mercies that God has given to us. So, that's enough for today. You guys got three sermons today. A church like ours, shaped by grace, will be a remarkable place. Be a remarkable place. I'll ask these questions up on the screen as you go. Just hang with me on this one. Where is Jesus inviting you to grow? I've said a lot of words today. Some of them maybe you followed, some not so much. But I'll just recap. Where is Jesus inviting you to grow today? Paul, Jesus himself, is urging you, inviting you to be shaped by grace. Some of the things that I've talked about today in a nutshell basically come down to these questions. Maybe Jesus is inviting you, and I want you to ask the question. Don't walk away feeling guilty. Don't walk away feeling like, man, I've got to sign up for everything now. I've got to do. That's not the idea. The idea is I'm inviting you, just like Paul is inviting you, and just like Jesus is inviting you to join together with God and be shaped by grace. And maybe for you, the invitation is just to marvel at the grace that you've been given. I was rattling off all sorts of different ways that God's given you grace, and maybe you just need to soak in that. That would be amazing. That would be a great start, to just read through the Bible and thank God on every page for different things that he's given you, the promises that he's made to you. Maybe it's secondly an invitation in an area of your life you're holding back from offering yourself to God. There's a piece of you that you know, I'm just holding on to that because I don't honestly want to change. My invitation to you is to offer your whole self to God. And then thirdly, is there some philosophy of this age? Is there some teaching? I mentioned a couple. There's dozens and dozens and dozens of things. Like, is there something in your life that you would say if you're sitting with God and you're asking the question, is this helping me grow more toward God? Is it helping me grow more like Christ? And the answer is no. Is there something you need to get rid of? Something you need to throw out? Trash that needs to go in the dumpster? Ask the Spirit for strength and power to do that. Or is it a pursuit of something that's the transformation? Is it some way that God's inviting you to join together, study His Word, read, learn, and grow, and be shaped by the grace that we see in Scripture? There are lots of different ways that God might be speaking to you today. I'm just going to pray and invite you to reflect on those questions, and then we'll sing a song and we'll close today. So, Father, we come today, and I just continue to be blown away. Whenever I open up your word, I see grace on every page. The way that you have entered into this world, given us a Savior who lived the life that we were meant to live, to give us an example of what that life could look like, to die the death that we deserve because of our sin, and to open up the possibility of salvation and of eternity with the living God. And then not only that, but your Spirit walks with us every single day, pricking our hearts, encouraging us, challenging us to grow and be morphed and be shaped by this grace that you've given. So help us as a church, help us as individuals, help us as a church in the nation to take seriously the call to follow Jesus with all of our hearts and minds and soul and strength. I pray that in Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Let's stand and sing our closing hymn, "And Can It Be?" There's some wonderful words in the verses. Fast bound in sin and nature's night, but yet we can be alive in him. We can be clothed in his righteousness. Let's sing together. Mm-hmm. Thou, my God. fast bound in sin and nature's night. Thine eye diffused a quickening ray. I woke the dungeon flamed with light. My chains fell off, my heart was free. I rose when
close this service. So I want to leave you with a benediction, a blessing, a challenge. It might sound a lot like the words of Romans 12, 1 and 2, if you want to raise your hands and hear these words. I urge you, my brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your whole bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Don't conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. Amen and amen. Have a great day, y'all.